And welcome to the Dr. Bob Show. One of the huge problems we have in the United States is abdominal pain. Sometimes we know where it's coming from, sometimes we don't. And it's getting worse and worse all around the world. And we're not sure why that is. There are two main causes we're going to be talking about on this show. Inflammation of the GI tract. One will be Crohn's disease, the other one will be ulcerative colitis. They're both inflammation of the GI tract, but there are other things that cause inflammation, and we're learning more and more about those, and the medicines are getting better and better, where that we now can expect or want or hope that will have a better quality of life, and some of that pain that just is devastating will go away. My guest is Dr. William Ergen. Dr. Ergen is a board-certified stomach specialist, gastroenterologist, and he'll be answering our questions as he does every day in his office. I'm Dr. Robert Overholt. I'll be your host for the next 30 minutes, and hopefully during that period of time, we'll be talking about exercise, eating properly, 7.5 hours sleep, and most of all, laughter in your life, and it will help abdominal pain also. A lot of information for you. We're talking with Dr. William Ergen, board-certified gastroenterologist, and we're going to be talking about inflammation in the GI tract. William, welcome to the Dr. Bob Show.
Thank you so much for having me.
When I first came into practice, long time ago, when we thought about inflammation and problems in the GI tract, we thought about two illnesses, ulcerative colitis, which was the large colon, and regional ileitis, which became Crohn's disease. What is it now?
It still is largely those two illnesses, and sometimes there's a little bit of overlap. We in gastroenterology, specifically people who practice inflammatory bowel disease almost daily.
Inflammatory bowel disease, that means inflammation inside or outside?
That's a great question. And it is inflammation inside. Now Crohn's, when it gets really bad, actually can eat through the entire lining.
Wow.
And that actually can be outside. And it can create abscesses and fistulas and those kinds of
things.
What's
a fistula?
So a fistula, in basically my line of work, is a communication between two structures.
So it gets so inflamed that it hooks onto a structure that comes by and forms a little tunnel.
You got it. And it can be a tunnel between two areas of intestine. It can be the intestine and the bladder. It can be the intestine and the skin. So sometimes these patients will show up in your office and, you know, the diagnosis is Crohn's, and you're like, huh. And then you examine them, and they've got a little sinus tract on their abdomen. And you're saying, huh, this is actually kind of an interesting case. And you end up getting CT scans and scopes and whatnot. So a lot goes into it.
Can you treat a fistula, canalization?
Nowadays, for the most part, at least the first line of defense is always using antibiotics first and foremost. Mm-hmm. Trying to get the medicines down, and then you come see us for a little bit more tests, usually an endoscopic procedure, some blood work, and then we're usually getting patients on a biologic medication, because by the time Crohn's is so bad to where it's fistulizing, we're in some trouble, and we got to use our most sacred weapons.
And most sacred weapon would be a biologic. Let's skip right to the biologic. We're going to come back. That's what we're going to talk a lot about later on. But in general, what's a biologic?
A biologic medication is a medicine that is synthesized in a lab. Usually these are antibodies, or what they call monoclonal antibodies. Monoclonal antibodies, and they're usually engineered so that it can block a particular signal that is dysregulated in Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. So somewhere along the way, you're signaling gets dysregulated, and these monoclonal antibodies attack and prevent that dysregulation.
Is that like sent from heaven?
It was in the late 90s when these came down. Originally, these medicines were used for rheumatoid arthritis, so our rheumatology colleagues Were very nice to let us borrow these. Some very good smart doctors who practiced gastroenterology in the Netherlands decided to use them for their patients with Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. It was a bit of a leap of faith, but their outcomes were actually very good initially, and have been so for a lot of these medicines for over 20 years.
So if you can isolate one of those illnesses, ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease, is there one that's worse necessarily?
It's a great question. It's one I get a lot. What I do is I sit a patient down and I say, listen, your illness is your illness. Don't be so focused on whether it's Crohn's or it's in one particular area or ulcerative colitis. Every patient does, they sort of interpret their own illness in a particular kind of way. I would say for the most part, they can both be very severe, requiring hospitalization, even surgery. Okay.
Wow.
And then they can also be very mild, requiring a little bit of medication, very close monitoring, and that's the key, very close monitoring, at least from us in the clinics, monitoring you with labs and scopes and scans and so forth.
Which one would you like to start off with, basically, if we had a classic patient, ulcerative colitis or Crohn's?
I would say we could start with a patient with Crohn's.
Okay. Crohn's disease is going to be what?
Usually it's presenting right where the end of the small intestine or the terminal ileum connects to the large intestine or the colon in the cecum. So it's usually in the ileocecal region.
Okay, so the small bowel goes into the large bowel at that area, the cecum's in between. That's where the problem usually is.
70 to 80% of the time, it usually is.
Can you make that examined by feeling the tummy and say, oh, you got pain right there, or do you have to do studies?
That's a great question. Very rarely, if you get a patient who is thin enough, you can actually feel the actual protuberant. It's almost a mass-like protuberance. And then comes the part where we're really doing the blood work, we're getting all the studies that we need, and usually a colonoscopy is required to make a diagnosis of Crohn's disease.
So when you do a colonoscopy, you go through the whole colon. If it's over here on the right, you go right over to the right, or you have to go all the way around the loop?
You unfortunately have to go all the way around the loop.
Is that difficult?
It can be, sure thing. Yeah, gastroenterologists, we have to practice this multiple times throughout our training in order to be able to get to this level, because by the time we're taking care of patients in the office, they're pretty sick, and sometimes you want to make sure that the procedure is as well tolerated as it can be, and so it does require a bit of sophisticated maneuvering and so forth to get over to the area.
So the colon starts at the rectum, the rectocolon area, it comes all the way up and then goes transverse and then goes down into the cecum there. And so you can, are you looking through at the colon when you're doing colonoscopy? Can you tell when you're coming to a curve?
Oh yeah, you can. Sometimes we'll kind of get to a particular area where we'll say, huh, it kind of makes a turn this way. And sometimes we've got a little water flush on our colonoscope, and that can help us guide through that area. Sometimes just some general maneuvering, and we've also got an air channel that can actually, the term we use is insufflate, or we can fill up that tube with air and we advance the scope on through, finding the area where we're trying to really look at for the patient.
So when you get all the way down to where you want to be, down in the cecum and the ileocecal area, what are you looking for?
If we think a patient has Crohn's disease, we're looking for any sign of inflammation, and that's the key.
What's it going to be? What are the signs of inflammation?
So usually, the classic term is a serpiginous or snake-like ulcer that you can see, and it doesn't discriminate. It can be on a fold, it can be down below. It can even create something called a stricture or a narrowing in the small intestine. And that's where that ulcer has inflamed, then it heals and it inflames, and that can even block our scope from advancing from that area into the small intestine.
That's pretty serious.
It can be pretty serious.
And that inflammation that's there, does it just go away if you put some soothing salt, some cream on it?
Sure. If I could do that, I tell you what, I would be, we would be, I don't know, they call me Nobel someone or another. No, if we could find a way to do that, that'd be great. But it actually makes my job a lot of fun, because it's not easy to come back and treat these patients, because they've got so many things that go into the problem. And then sort of sorting those out before you get to the right medicine is always an important thing.
So you get down there and you find an abnormal area, and you, in your mind, you're confirmed. You got to establish that. Do you have to get biopsies?
Better believe it.
What's a biopsy?
So a biopsy is a great question. We actually take a little, we call it a little forceps tube, okay, and it passes through the scope, and it's got these little prongs on the end of it. And
we can, getting too good.
I believe this was your brother that invented this whole concept. So, and we can actually pass that through. We can look with, while we're looking at an ulcer, let's say, and we can take that forceps, biopsy the edge of the ulcer, remove it, send it off in a jar of formalin for a pathologist to look at, and they can actually make the diagnosis.
And so the pathologist is looking for, he's looking for what he sees, but when he sees inflammation, he automatically, you may have a problem with, this patient may have Crohn's disease.
You got it. And that's something we sort out a lot in my practice in particularly, because we're always looking, and I say, this looks like Crohn's disease. There are a few other things that could be going on. The patient could be taking a lot of NSAIDs, ibuprofen, Motrin, whatnot. But usually, if it's a chronic inflammatory condition, more than likely it's Crohn's. And the pathologist, if they know what they're looking at, they're able to give us the answer.
Is there a good treatment for this?
There's good treatment now.
And there's good treatment now, meaning like it may be better now. And that's what we'll be talking about. For Crohn's disease, what is the treatment and how good is it and what can we expect? A lot of information. We're talking with Dr. William Ergen, and we're talking about inflammation in the GI tract, and we've been talking about Crohn's disease, inflammation where the small bowel hooks up into the large bowel, and the pathologist gets a piece of the tissue and he says, you may have Crohn's disease. And then we talked about the treatment for that. What is the treatment? You say it's pretty good for Crohn's disease.
Nowadays, it has become revolutionized. And
that
really
sounds
pretty
impressive.
With the advent of the biologic medications. So back 20, 30 years ago, as I'm sure when you were first starting out, it was...
40 years ago.
I was going to say 10. It was usually steroids, prednisone. So when you thought someone was having a flare of that inflammation, you give them prednisone, you'd change their diet. You'd say, don't eat anything that'll stress the gut out. No vegetables or those kinds of things, real bland food. And the point is that since then, now we have these really amazing biologic medicines that are the monoclonal antibodies, as I've said before, that have really helped give our patients life back.
If you put somebody on prednisone, it's an anti-inflammatory medication. Mm-hmm. You sometimes could see people with a round moon face. Is that a side effect?
Unfortunately, yes.
And bruising and lots of side effects from. So we try and stay away from prednisone if we can. And so eventually you came out with newer medicines that allowed you to get away from prednisone and use these monoclonal antibodies.
That's correct.
Oh, good. I didn't mean to jump ahead on that, but let's walk through that as far as Crohn's disease goes.
So as far as Crohn's disease, when I diagnose someone with a moderate to severe form, and as we were talking about earlier, if you have those strictures, or if you're losing weight, or if you're having significant abdominal pain, putting a patient on these medicines, if monitored appropriately with all the right tools in place, you can really reverse that inflammation. And basically, you have to do two things. You have to rule out chronic infections. The first one is tuberculosis.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And then you have to rule out hepatitis B, okay? And then when that is done, and you've basically ensured the patient doesn't have those infections, then you can start them on this very sophisticated anti-inflammatory medicines.
So you escape having to give them prednisone.
You can actually escape having to give them prednisone. The TNF-alpha antagonists, which you mentioned earlier, these biologics, actually do the job of prednisone. They can do that and more. And the concept is inducing and maintaining. So inducing is you take an inflamed state to a normal state, right? So those ulcers I was telling you about, those are gone, okay? And then you maintain the normal gut tissue. Well, these medications do both. And that's really been a game changer.
Wow. Now, we used to call this inflammation tumor necrosis factor. It sounds like you're looking for a tumor and all this, but that was the inflammatory product. And so you've got the medicine that's blocking tumor necrosis factor?
Exactly. They're called TNF-alpha or tumor necrosis factor inhibitors. And they basically prevent the expression of that protein in a patient.
So the patient gets better?
Patient gets better, and they can get better pretty quick, too.
How long do they expect to be better?
Well, and some of that does depend on how sick they are when you're making the diagnosis. So someone who's, let's say, been feeling bad for about 3 months, you can usually begin to see them turn the tide in about a week or 2 weeks.
Whoa, that is fairly quick in medicine for a chronic illness. So somebody's been having pain for a long, long time, cramping abdominal pain, some blood in the stools, maybe even fistulas. You can put them on these medications, and now when they start feeling better, how good does that mean?
Well, that's a good point. And in fact, I spend probably the majority of my time in the office after someone's already feeling better. And the first question is, doctor, does this end here? Can I stop these medicines? And the first thing we have to tell a patient is no. This is a chronic process. And unfortunately, even after you're feeling great, you're going to have to stay on these medicines. We'll monitor it appropriately, but you need to make sure that this is maintained over time. And a lot of times we'll have to repeat a scope or do some more blood work to ensure the inflammation is gone.
I see a lot of patients that would say, don't you ever stop that medicine. It's been so good for me that please don't ever stop it. Please don't do that. So you have gone from monoclonal antibodies for tumor necrosis factor alpha into newer, better biologics. Is that right?
That's correct. And the big agents that we use right now is something called an integrin inhibitor. Uh-huh. Okay. And that is called Entyvio, and there's another medicine.
Entyvio,
yes, sir. And then there's another one called Stelara, and that is an IL-12-23 inhibitor. Basically, for the patient and the viewing audience, understand that these are other molecules that are expressed in very high levels in patients with inflammation. And these medicines block those.
So IL...
12 and 23. Interleukin is the fancy
Interleukins.
Term.
Yes, so sir. We can jump on those individuals when we learn that they're causing the trouble and can direct treatment specifically against them. So that's an improvement model in treatment.
It's been a huge improvement model. And we've actually found that these medicines are really safe, that turning off these very molecules from expressing at such high levels is really a very safe way going forward. There's very little risk going down the road if monitored appropriately. And you've got someone like us monitoring them with blood work and repeat scopes and scans to make sure there's no inflammation going forward. So really, it's a win-win nowadays.
I was smiling because I was thinking of somebody that was having such a problem, was doing so well, and got a routine case of diarrhea. They said, is it coming back? And I'm sure that's very frightening to a patient.
And believe it or not, we'll have what is called deep remission, okay, which is a concept that's a little bit newer for the GI audience. Mm-hmm. And that means that the patient is feeling well. You were asking about that. That means that their scope, when we do a repeat colonoscopy and those ulcers I was telling you about earlier, they're gone. And then we actually biopsy that tissue, and the pathologist tells us the inflammation's gone. That is the gold standard. So when we get to deep remission and we have a patient on these medicines and they're telling me, oh gosh, Dr. Ergen, I'm not feeling so great. Could this be my IBD coming back?
That must be scary.
It's real scary. So, but unfortunately, we're pretty well equipped to be able to deal with that.
Now, we have circumvented the diagnosis ulcerative colitis. Is that the same kind of inflammation, or maybe a little bit different, or is the presentation a little different?
It is definitely a little different.
And that's what we're going to be talking about when we come back. Ulcerative colitis, how is it different? How good is the treatment for that? What can we do now? And I know it's a whole lot better than it was. You'll want to stay tuned. This is fascinating. We're talking with Dr. William Ergen, and we've been talking about inflammation in the GI tract. We've been talking about Crohn's disease, inflammation of the GI tract over on the right side. Now we're going to be talking about ulcerative colitis. That's where the colon is on the left side that we'll be talking about predominantly. So let's go to ulcerative colitis. What is that and what is it like?
Ulcerative colitis is a potentially devastating problem. It is chronic and it is inflammation of the colon, as stated before.
And what kind of symptoms does that give?
The most telltale sign that I get from a patient are the following. It's uncontrolled incontinence of stool with some blood, usually. There can be mucus discharge. And it's this constant issue with nighttime stooling as well. So if a patient of mine is getting up out of bed to go run to the restroom, that's usually a concerning sign that there may be some inflammation going on, particularly in the colon.
Now, a lot of people have to get up in the middle of the night to go tinkle.
That's true.
But not to have a bowel movement.
That's correct. And then there should be a differentiation that there, if there's blood and there's mucus discharge, then...
How bloody?
You know, it can vary, depends. Sometimes patients will expel a lot of blood, and so they'll come and actually tell us it filled the toilet bowl. It can be a few drops. The key is persistence of symptoms, because when it just continues without any stopping or getting better, then you ought to come see your specialist and just give us a call.
Yeah, well, I think anytime somebody's got blood in the stool that's persistent, they need to be saying, hey, I need to see my GI doctor. That's a sign. Somebody might think it was colon cancer, something like that, GI bleeding like that. But so when you see the patient that's having diarrhea at nighttime, cramping abdominal pain, frequent diarrhea, some blood in the stools, some tissue in the stools, what's the stool like when you look in the bowl?
A lot of times it can be completely unformed. It's just pure water. Sometimes there's actually blood coating the stool, and it's these sort of floaty stools that just... On top of the water. It's just essentially like there's been malabsorption or lack of absorption of nutrients. And that's usually also a telltale sign.
And so they've been saying, I've been having this for 2 days. You start thinking of ulcerative colitis, or we've been having it for 2.5 months.
Now, 2.5 months is going to usually be more common. Yeah. 2.5 days can be a lot of things.
Yeah, somebody wants to stay away from figuring out the doctor's going to have to do a colonoscopy. Sure. Nobody looks forward to that. But when you see abnormal stools and you suspect ulcerative colitis, how's a diagnosis made?
First and foremost, it's always with a colonoscopy. That's got to be your telltale test of choice. Usually we will send some stool tests because there are some mimickers or things that can look just like ulcerative colitis.
There are
infections. C. diff infection can look a lot like ulcerative colitis, which is a chronic infection. There's a couple of others like Campylobacter, E. coli can sometimes present with this same kind of pattern.
Vibrio, is that, comes to the back of my mind.
I mean, Vibrio certainly can as well. I mean, those are things that should be ruled out and addressed before.
Okay. And so they're ruled out, and then you've made the diagnosis. In the old days, that was really a devastating diagnosis. How about the young days? How about now? What can you tell the patient, and how do you start treating them, and how do you walk into the biologics?
That's a great question. The first thing that we're always doing is making sure that we're controlling the patient such that they're not ending up in the hospital, so they don't get dehydrated, they're not becoming malnourished or losing nutrients from the gut. So as long as that's not there, we can usually transition them with the prednisone initially, and then we turn them onto the biologics that we've mentioned before, the tumor necrosis factor inhibitors, as well as the IL-12/23 inhibitors or the integrin inhibitors. All three of those classes are used fairly regularly. And there's even some new ones as well, something called a JAK inhibitor, and there's even a new one on the market
J-A-K
called
JAK inhibitor.
JAK, and there's even a new one called an S1P inhibitor. And these last two are complete new guys on the block.
So what you're telling me is every day you're getting something better and better and better and better that makes the patient essentially not know they've got it, but they got to keep coming back for their medication.
You got it. And that's a key. We can simply give the patient their life back. They can go once or twice a day, they gain their weight, the bleeding goes away. They're at work, at school, with friends and family.
How does that make you feel as a physician?
It's why I do what I do.
Yeah, it must be so gratifying. So in the Dr. Bob Show, we frequently talk about eating properly, exercising, getting 7.5 hours sleep, and most of all, laughter in your life. Are all of those important?
They are absolutely important.
Is one more important? You got to eat right. You got to have sleep in order to let anything heal. You got to have the right kind of food that your doctor tells you what you can have and can't have. Where does laughter play a part? Socialization.
Laughter and the human connection when it comes to inflammatory bowel disease is a huge component. If patients can't have that and they can't do the things like go to church, school, interact with people, then it's usually it can be quite a devastating problem, even if we are giving them all the medications that we can, such that we've discussed already.
William Ergen, you are an outstanding teacher. Thank you so much for coming to the Dr. Bob Show. I have learned so much, and so has the viewing audience. Will you come back and be with us again?
I would love to. It would be my honor, Dr. Bob. Thanks so much for having me on.
A lot of information. Tape it somehow and watch it over and over. Abdominal pain? Go see your GI doctor. It's all the time that we have for this show. Hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have.